Hello everyone. I hope you enjoyed lunch. And my name is Johannes Steigert. I'm working at Comscope as an RF engineer. I don't know if you know Comscope. Comscope is a big US company which has two main businesses. One is the wired infrastructure and the other one is the wireless communication sector. In Buchdorf, that means our German team, is responsible for the RF repeaters. Today's talk will be about the design and the simulation of a planar inverted F antenna. The talk will take about 25 minutes and I'd like to answer your questions afterwards. Today's agenda begins with a short introduction. After that, we will look on the very basics of computational electromagnetics. And afterwards, we will have a practical design example, namely the planar F antenna. Afterwards, I will sum up the talk with a short conclusion. Let's come to the basics of computational electromagnetics. Oh, sorry. So now, the most important question is, what do computational electromagnetic solvers do? I think for some people it looks like magic, but in fact it is no magic, that solvers approximate the Maxwell equations. The different solvers which are available can be separated in three main categories. The three main categories can be separated in how they approximate the Maxwell equations and how they discretize the simulation domain and area. Three main types which are available are the finite element method, the finite differences in time domain method, and the method of moments. Today's talk will cover the method of moments because National Instruments Axiom Solver is a perfect example of that. Let's come to a short introduction of the method of moments. The method of moments is a frequency domain method. The discretization is done using triangles. Conducting areas and interfaces between dielectrics are discretized in triangles. And these discretized triangles are used to solve the integral forms of Maxwell equations. Let's come to the computational technique. The computation of the current is done for each of these cells. And the total current is calculated by a superposition of each of the cells. That is demonstrated in that graph. No worries about that the discretization is done here in cylinders. In reality, the method of moment uses triangles. But I wanted to demonstrate it in a quite simple way. So the current is calculated for each of these segments of a wire, for example, and after that the current is computed as superposition of all currents. And also the total electrical field is computed from the contribution of every segment. On this slide you can see the trade-off triangle. I mean, for engineers, it's a kind of daily business to handle trade-offs. I think every one of you knows that. You can see on the left side of the triangle the number of cells, which is directly related with the size of the simulation domain and the discretization cell size. On the other side of the triangle, you can see the simulation accuracy. And at the top of the triangle, you see the simulation time. So our job as engineers is to find a suitable solution and trade-off between each of these three parts to achieve the best performance of the simulation. Here, an example of a trade-off, or better, of a mismatched trade-off is displayed. I've done at least 4 simulations with a fixed structure. Only the cell size, the discretization cell size, is varied in the different traces. The cell size varies from 0.1, 0.5 to at least 0.05 millimeters. And as you see, at a fixed structure, the simulation results strongly depends on the cell size. Only for the last 2 iteration steps, from 0.1 millimeters towards 0.05 millimeters, you can't see any change. It's the blue trace, and the violet one is covered behind. So what I want to say with this slide, we have to choose the cell size such small that we have a result which is accurate enough. So, as finalization of this theoretical view on computational electromagnetics, I want to give you a kind of receipt for simulations in every tool you want to use. First important issue while simulating a structure is the understanding. And to my mind, that's a very exemplary point. You have to understand what you want to simulate. You have to analyze the problem, and you have to get some expectations on the simulation results. After you achieved that understanding, you have to simulate. That means you have to select first the tool you want to use, then you have to set up the tool, you have to do the simulation, and at the end, you have to compare your expectations with the simulation results. And afterwards, you have to refine the simulation, and maybe you have to optimize it. And in the end, you have to verify your simulation results using prototyping, measurement, and real-life testing. That was it from the theoretical view. Let's come to a design example. I've chosen the inverted F antenna as example. The inverted F antenna is shown on the right side of the slide. It consists of a lambda quarter wavelength resonator, a shorting pin, and a feeding line, and a large ground area. The inverted F antenna, short IFA, was first introduced in the mid of 1958. And was used in the military area for assault missiles and radar. In modern communication systems, this kind of antenna is used as planar antenna on circuit boards, and modern communication systems are mobile phones, for example. Yeah. And sometimes you have to use the antenna below 1 gigahertz, and then the resonator would become very long due to the quarter wavelength, and in that case, we see sometimes that people use the meandered version of the resonator. I come back to that later. How can we model such an inverted F antenna? As starting point, I've decided to go back to the slot antenna. The slot antenna consists of a ground area, 2 shorting pins or traces on the right side and the left side, a feeding source, and a half wavelength resonator. When we have a look at the voltage and the current distribution on this resonator, you can see that we have a voltage maximum at the middle of the resonator and voltage zeros at the end. In the current distribution, we see a zero at the middle of the resonator, and a maximum current at the shorting traces, left and right of the structure. When you have a deeper look on that middle point, you can see the zero current and the voltage maximum. And when you think of an open resonator has a voltage maximum at the end and a current maximum at the very beginning. So, therefore, we can model that slot antenna using an open resonator. Another point of view for the modeling is to build the equivalent circuit diagram. And as mentioned before, we can model the resonator as capacitance. But if you have a look at the Smith diagram, you transform your matching point, your ideal matching, from the 50 ohms towards an impedance far away from the 50 ohms. And to transform back to this 50 ohms, you introduce the short trace at the end of the open. So thereof, we don't have to use any external matching components. We can ensure a proper matching condition only by these wires. I've talked about expectations on the simulated structure. Here you see an example of a specification. The antenna should be resonant for LTE band 14, which goes up from 758 to 798 megahertz. So thereof, we have a bandwidth of around 40 megahertz, and we decided to have a matching of at least 10 dB within that frequency range. And when it comes to the antenna gain, we expected a gain between 0 and 2.5 dBi, because 2.5 dBi is the theoretical gain of an half-wavelength dipole. The size is also a criterion we have to ensure. We are limited to 100 millimeters times 60 millimeters because we are restricted with the hardware radio module. When it comes to the simulation, you can model the antenna structure as it can be seen on this right side of the slide. We've modeled the antenna in a way that we keep the restrictions of size, 60 millimeters times 100 millimeters. And as you see on the table on the left side of the slide, we achieved a center frequency of around 772, and maximum antenna gain of 1.66 dBi, and a bandwidth of 35 megahertz. We verified that simulation in real life, and at the first measurement, we achieved a shifted center frequency. The frequency was around 787 megahertz, but the bandwidth was quite the same. So we did further investigations and tuned the antenna. And finally, we achieved a center frequency around 775 megahertz and an antenna gain of 1.35 dBi. What means tuning? The simplest approach was to lengthen the resonator, so we are shifting the resonant frequency to a lower frequency. As I told you before, we had deviations compared between the simulation and the real results. You can see that in a graphical display here in this plot. The red trace is the real measurement, while the blue trace is the simulated one. And the orange one is the structure after tuning. As I told you, the optimization was done by length tuning, and the variations are related to deviations of the used FR4 substrate, the non-simulated test cable, and maybe a non-ideal free space in the test chamber. Here's a quite cool feature of Microwave Office Axiom Simulator. You can display the 3D antenna patterns inside the structure you simulated, so you have an idea how it behaves together with the structure. As you see, the simulated structure has a roughly donut-shaped pattern, which was expected when you think of an quarter wave and half wave dipole. The maximum antenna gain of 1.66 dB is in the XZ plane, and we have a sharp notch in the center at the XY and YZ plane. And also very cool feature of microwave office is that we can display the current distribution and the voltage distribution directly on the structure. As you see, as expected, we have more current at the begin of the feeding line when the short trace and the open resonator are intersected. And we have a voltage maximum, that means less current at the end of the open resonator. We can also see a little skin effect of the edges of the resonator, which quite good meets the theoretical background. On this slide, you can see our measured antenna blade radiation patterns compared to the simulated ones. As you see, we have a perfectly shaped circle in the theta equals zero and the p equals zero dimension, but we have two sharp notches, as mentioned before on the previous slide. The real measurements are shifted from the center, what could be a measurement deviation, but are roughly similar to the simulated patterns, what gives us a good idea that the antenna is working as expected. And also, as mentioned before, the antenna gain is around 0.3 dB away from the simulated result at maximum. Other thing we did was, after the verification of the simulated structure, we wanted to adapt the same antenna with the same mechanical footprint for LTE band 13. So the idea was to use AWR's, AWR's optimizer, and first we introduced a simple matching circuit using ideal components. Then we've done the optimization with the AWR optimizer, found an approximate solution. Afterwards, we've replaced the ideal components with the realistic ones out of the AWR library. And then we used another cool feature of microwave office, the so-called yield analysis. The yield analysis does various simulations with differing component values in between the components' tolerances. And thereof you can get an idea what happens due to the component tolerances. You can see that on this slide. Another thing we did is that we varied the epsilon R, so we can ensure that our design fits our requirements under all circumstances. You can see the light blue, the light red, and the light orange traces are related to the deviations of the component tolerances. And the blue, the orange, and the red solid lines are representing the variation of the epsilon R. And as you see, we can meet our requirements under all circumstances, what gives a quite good idea of the antenna performance in production for a first step. That's it so far to the design of the inverted F antenna. Now I want to summarize the former slides. We did the design for an inverted F antenna for LTE band 14. Theoretical calculations were demonstrated with Axiom. The simulated performance has been verified with real measurements, and the antenna has been modified to be resonant for LTE band 13. In the end of the presentation, a yield analysis was done regarding the component tolerances and the substrate variations. That's it so far for my presentation today. It's one sentence left I want to tell you. A simulation tool only throws back what you give into it. Thanks for your attention.